If you're a sports fan, every year starts with hopes and dreams, the same old thoughts and the same old fears.
So, take yourself back to January 2010. Imagine you've got a crystal ball. What would you want to know?
Who'll be fired? Who'll be hired? Who'll be fastest? Who'll be first? Who'll get gold? Who'll get sold? Who'll come off best? Who'll come off worst? Will he stay? Will he play? What's he worth? Could he rule the earth? Will it rain? Will it pour? Will it shine? Will he score? Will he retire? Will he come back? Will we ever beat the men in black? Will we go down? Will we go up? What's more important, the league or the cup? Will it be off? How much do we care? Will it be on? If it is, who'll be there? Win or lose, luck or fate? Who'll be remembered? Who will be great?
Find out all the answers over the next hour as we relive the highs and lows from Welsh sport in 2010.
Welcome to BBC Wales Sports Review of the Year from the venue that gave you one of Wales's most magical sporting moments. Here we are on the now globally famous 2010 course, where golf captured the nation's imagination back in October. But all year, it was football that dominated the headlines.
The pain of the playoffs may still be sore, but the dream of Premier League football is still alive. And with Newport County back in the big time and a new poster boy for Welsh football, it wasn't such a bad year, or was it?
It would be impolite not to tell you of what is to come. I am about to recount a story of Welsh football. It may enlighten you, it might entertain you, but at times it will horrify you. If any of you feel you do not wish to subject your nerves to such excitement, well, you were warned. So, if you're a die-hard fan or a nervous newcomer, welcome to the tale of Welsh football in the year 2010. In the League of Wales, everything was quiet enough. The citizens of Bangor City won the cup, and the new saints demonstrated their divinity. A club once pronounced dead, the resurrected Newport County ascended from the Conference South to join Wrexham, a team still locked in a vortex of dreams about a return to the professional game. For Swansea and Cardiff, the season promised so much, but two of the most blood-curdling shockers ever witnessed were about to unfold. Fairy stories became horror stories. Cardiff's start in the FA Cup was put on ice. In their first scene, Souza's Swansea were killed off at Leicester. When Cardiff did get to play, they went on a mini run to crash into a Russian monolith at Chelsea.
Jumper has put Cardiff City level!
Outplayed, but not outsung. Overwhelmed by debt and facing court battles to survive, off the field, Cardiff's year slid between menace and mischief. On the field, for Cardiff and Swansea, the championship was to spiral into a fearful finish. How Swansea wished for a goal scorer. The division's lowest scorers with 40 goals, they finished in seventh place. A victory on the final day, and they would have made the playoffs instead of Blackpool. The grey man, Paulo Souza, was to leave for pastures new. Cardiff had spent the season becalmed in the playoff places. Their year was always going to be about getting to Wembley. In the first leg of the semi-final, everything went according to plan.
He's taken everybody by surprise!
The second leg unravelled into a cliffhanger.
It's another good touch for Chopra! And maybe they're going to reach this final now. And here's Fryett! And they're back in it! It's going to creep over! It's into the back of the net! And there's hesitation. Is it a penalty? Yes!
The penalty shootout saved their souls. Then a bright Saturday in May was Cardiff's day of destiny.
City draw first blood in the race to reach the Premier League.
Their rite of passage was derailed when their lead man hobbled off. Millions in the red, Cardiff had lost their lottery ticket. Blackpool, out for a day trip, boarded their roller coaster ride into the Premier League. Football in Wales in 2010 had a hair-raising plot. For the national team, the year became a horror sequel. In the European Championships draw, Wales were pitted against England, the Swiss, Bulgaria, and Montenegro. John Toshack's vision for a younger world was coming to an end. Toshack was followed by the under-21s manager, Brian Flynn, a caretaker for a haunted house. And then the powers of Welsh football searched for their new man.
The new national team manager, Mr. Gary Speed.
1-0 Blackpool! The new boys are 3-0 up!
They were brilliant.
It could have been either of us.
The new season in full flow. The cloud of nightmares lifts. The horror recedes. Cardiff had lost their homeboy and brought another back home and acquired their first English international. Swansea brought their new manager, Brendan Rodgers, to visit Legoland for the first time. He brought their supernatural game. Cardiff and Swansea both fantasizing about becoming the first teams from Wales to play in the richest league on earth, where you will find a young Welshman. Gareth Bale of Tottenham.
Bale! Oh, yes! Bale! Oh, what a strike! Gareth Bale for Tottenham, great goal! How about that for skill?
Sport is where we share collective dreams. But football has been the most dreamlike of all. It took us to the depths of our worst fears. It engaged with our nightmares. But football in Wales came out of its curse. And now, for 2011.
Well, let's hope we get a Welsh team in the Premier League, one of our conference teams back in the Football League, and maybe, just maybe, Wales's new management team can lead us to a European Championship or a World Cup. Not too much to ask. Plenty more to come on the 2010 Sports Review.
Is Welsh rugby heading in the right direction?
Sorry.
Or are they lost at sea?
Cheer the men over, Pen. Over, Pen.
This is no ordinary trip.
Later on, Captain Eddie Butler and co. go exploring for the truth.
So just as the Ryder Cup drama was unfolding here in the beautiful Usk Valley on that wet October weekend, there were 160 Welsh athletes going for gold on another continent, enjoying an Indian summer at an event that almost didn't happen.
This was always going to be more than just Delhi and sport and the Commonwealth. This was a declaration of intent by India, the new superpower. All going horribly wrong.
This is BBC Radio.
And says facilities at the Commonwealth Games Stadium in Delhi has collapsed.
Three high-profile English defending champions
of the head of Australia's Olympic Committee has said that the Commonwealth Games
is absolutely crucial day for the future of the Commonwealth Games.
Top names, including Welsh cyclist Geraint Thomas, stayed away. It was with huge local relief that the curtain went up and the sport of bashing the host nation gave way to competition between those who had come to India.
The first final of the Commonwealth Games in 2010 in Delhi. Don't rule out Jazz Carling. Look at Jazz Carling up in Sue. Jazz Carling could get a medal. Could this be a medal for Wales? 36 years, it was the last one. It is too, you know, it's a silver, I think it is. A fantastic medal.
It hasn't kind of really sunk in yet, but
I'm just so happy. We were talking kind of a few weeks ago, and they said that a Welsh woman hadn't kind of won a medal for so many years, and so it's just kind of an honour to be here.
Young Becky Jones, who comes from Abergavenny, next to go. Start here is young Becky James really throwing the gauntlet down, and that is a new lifetime best for her, and she is the new leader.
In the end, a bronze for Becky James in the time trial, but she was soon in contention again in the sprint.
Look at James, she's gone down the inside. A brilliant move by a sprinter. Mears moved out. James took the invitation. The door was open, and young Becky James is on the front. Has she got the power? James coming up to the line. Oh, it was so close. Becky James representing Wales, and that is a very, very popular medal achievement.
The popularity of medal winning went from one track to another. Jenny McLaughlin in the T37 sprint.
Jenny McLaughlin of Wales is having a great run here. McLaughlin, second for Wales.
Caris Parry in the hammer.
64.93 into second place.
To finish off a long season with a medal is something else.
Few have produced more tear-jerking moments at major games than Michaela Breeze.
Punch it. Good. Yep. Bring it forward.
There were bound to be a few more here after the smiles.
So, the last lift of her weightlifting career. Strong, clean. Stand up. Come on, Michaela. Come on, come on. No.
Oh, she gave it everything, but it just wasn't in her anymore.
The last attempt of her weightlifting career, and it's been a fantastic career both for Wales and for Great Britain.
Pool of tears and the pool of medals.
Gemma Lowe's second fastest qualifier for Wales in five. Gets the bronze. Great medal for Wales.
Wales's medal tally rose to seven, all won by women. Then a joint bronze for Georgia Davis. Jazz time again. Carlin against Rebecca Adlington in the 400-metre freestyle final.
The silver's gone to Australia, and the bronze has gone to Jazz Carlin. And Jazz Carlin, silver on the 200, and now bronze on the 4. And I'm joined now by Jazz Carlin. Well, Jazz, what a week that was for you girls in the pool.
Yeah, it was kind of amazing. I think we kind of didn't really expect it. And we knew it was kind of one of the strongest teams that Wales have ever had in the pool. And so we kind of just wanted to go there and aim for the medals. And three of the girls came away with medals, so we couldn't really complain with that.
And what was the atmosphere like in the week? Because everybody was talking about the girls are blazing a trail out there in Delhi.
Yeah, it was really good. I mean, in the Welsh block, everyone kind of always had a smile on the face. And I think that was kind of the general kind of gist of how everyone was feeling. And I think it was nice to come away with the medals that we did. And it was kind of a bonus. And obviously out in Delhi, it was a different experience for all of us. But I think it was all kind of a great experience for us.
And when you headed out to Delhi, did you expect a medal?
It's hard because you've got to kind of see how you're going through the year, and I'd had a mixture of positives and negatives because I'm just missed out on the 400 final, being the third Brit at European, so that was a bit of a disappointment for me. So to go out there, I just wanted to go out there and give a good race, and obviously to come away with two medals was a bonus. I was kind of aiming for one, but to come away with two was just it's such an incredible feeling for me.
And you, Georgia and Gemma, are all training together now. Do you ever wind the boys up about the lack of medals in the pool?
Sometimes. I mean, it was nice to kind of come away with the girls' medals, but obviously Tom, Dave and all the other guys are really good friends of mine, so I kind of wanted them to do well as well, and it's kind of like they're brothers to me, so it's kind of difficult, but it is the banter as well.
Jazz, great to see you. Thank you very much indeed, and many congratulations on your wonderful success.
Thank you.
In 2010. Well, not to be outdone by the Welsh swimmers, Wales's cyclists were also on track for medals all over the world.
What a year for Geraint Thomas, winner of the British National Road Race and third in the British National Time Trial. But it was on the Tour de France as part of Team Sky he really impressed, taking second place on stage three of the Tour, wearing the white jersey and holding on to the young rider's jersey from stages three to six.
Geraint Thomas, great to see you. Take me back to the Tour de France. How good was that?
It was a dream. It was just unbelievable. You know, like when you're a kid, you grow up of like being the best in you can in like a certain sport, and the Tour de France is that's the ultimate, you know. And to even ride it was a dream of mine, and to be second on a stage and, you know, beat Lance Armstrong in quite a few stages, which I'm quite happy about, you know. And then to be second overall for the first week and wear the white jersey, it was just a dream come true and nothing I really expected. I went there to help Brad and to get him the best result he could as a support role, and, you know, I had my individual glory at the start, and amazing. Just want to really build on that now.
So after your experience at the Tour de France, then you have to make a pretty big decision to pull out the Commonwealth Games. Do you still stand by that decision, Geraint?
Yeah, definitely, because, you know, from the advice I got from the medical guys and, you know, at the end of the day, I don't have a spleen, which produces white blood cells, which fight infections, you know. And just the risk of, if I did catch something, getting over it would be that much longer and, you know, just take a chunk off next year, which would knock onto the Olympics. And, like, the Commie Games is, you know, you get to wear that Welsh jersey. But at the end of the day, I see it that when I'm out there and riding in the Tour de France and things, you know, I'm there representing Wales. And, you know, I'm the only Welsh guy out there, the only Welsh pro racing on the European scene. And just every time I get that jersey on, even though, you know, it may be Sky or GB or whatever, but at the end of the day, I'm still there and still representing Wales. But, you know, hopefully Glasgow is... I'll be there for sure. I'm definitely. There's no dengue flu there, is there?
Yeah, I don't think so. Geraint, great to see you. Have a great 2011.
Cheers, thanks.
Nicole Cook had a good year, but not a great one by her impeccable standards. Fourth in the World Championships and third in the British Road Race Championships. Not bad. I want to know your name. But it was Abercrombie cyclist Becky James who stole the limelight this year, adding two European under-23 goals to her Commonwealth bronze and silver medals in Delhi.
So a great year for Welsh cycling. We're always talking about Geraint Thomas and Nicole Cook, but this year, Becky James, it was all about you. How did you cope with that?
It's crazy you saying that to me because it's not sunk in. Well, it is just about sinking in now, being the end of the year. But it couldn't have gone much better, to be honest.
You're in Manchester now. How are you coping with life up there?
I'm really enjoying it, really settled down and getting into the full-time training. It's hard work, but I love it.
So take me back to Delhi then. When you went out on that plane, did you honestly think you'd do as well as you did?
No, I didn't expect that, and I didn't want to put any pressure on myself. And, you know, you go out there with hopes and dreams of coming back with medals, but that's the last thing you think about. You just got to concentrate on exactly what you want to do in your races. And to come away with a bronze and a silver medal, just could not have asked for any more. I had like such tough competition being up against Anna Meares and the other Australian riders. It was such a good experience.
And you pushed Anna Meares, and in many ways it was the girls that got Wales off to a flyer, wasn't it, in that first week? What are your memories of that first week, Becky?
Oh, it was absolutely amazing. And, you know, seeing that board downstairs and where everyone, all the Welsh people were, and seeing faces of all the girls up on the board. It was female dominated. We had girl power that week, but, you know, just the whole experience in Delhi was absolutely amazing.
What does a Commonwealth medalist do over Christmas then? Do you indulge in any way? What do you do? Christmas Day? Day off?
Yeah, day off this year. Not mountain bike this year, like last year when I went out in the snow. But hopefully just a day with the family, relaxing while I can before I get back up to Manchester to train hard.
Well, Becky, many congratulations on a fantastic 2010 and Merry Christmas to you. Thank you very much indeed. Well, more from the Commonwealths later in the programme.
Still to come, it was the week when the eyes of the world were on Wales.
Brilliantly done. The whole staging of the event was a tribute to Wales and what they had achieved in that Ryder Cup.
In 2010, Welsh rugby once again managed to dazzle, baffle, amaze and frustrate. So here's Eddie Butler to try to make sense of it all.
Mm-hmm.
a scurvy crew if ever I saw one. Mutinous scum, Hornblower.
I'm sorry, Captain Kirk. It was all that was left. The pick of the nation's talent has been press-ganged elsewhere.
What to do with the feeder systems of Welsh rugby is an ongoing debate. But club rugby is no Davy Jones's locker. It lives on. Neath won the Premiership, Llanelli the Cup.
So be it. Now listen, men. 100 years ago, the Terra Nova set sail from Cardiff on one of the greatest adventures of all time.
Were you there, sir?
Ah, the wit of the Matelow. Tell them, Hornblower.
Scott of the Antarctic Men.
A name to inspire us. Scott.
Gibbs?
Quinnell?
Johnson, sir.
Johnson will do, Seaman Grassroots. The buccaneer spirit that guides us. What is the matter, Seaman Overpun?
Me timbers are shearing, sir.
The buccaneer spirit. The white bird of freedom that glides over the water. What say you, Seaman Lipmike?
The gannet.
The albatross.
Tell them, Hornblower.
The osprey's men.
The stock of the Magnus League is on the rise. End-of-season playoffs have given it a real bite. And the Ospreys became champions of this combative rugby culture of the Celts.
Leave Wales and head due south. If only it was so simple. Do that out of Cardiff and you bump into Devon or France or Spain. Mind you, ships and rugby dreams have foundered on the rocks of continental Europe.
It was the coast of the Basque Country that claimed the Ospreys. They lost the Biarritz in San Sebastian, and another year passed without Welsh success in the Heineken Cup.
On the other hand, if your expedition is well prepared, then travelling can be a pleasure.
In the Amlin Cup, the Blues won away at Newcastle, Wasps, and finally Toulon to become a champion of Europe.
Damn it, damn it, damn it, where is Wales? Where are we? There's madness in the salt air, cabin fever.
What's it all about,
Alfie?
Rugby's going south. Ancient Alfie was going west. But then he suddenly went north. But nothing could be as bonkers as Gav. A freezing dip, a hot dance, the poster. No more of this. He might even play soon.
This navigation business, you have to understand that you can lay the finest plans, you can chart the best courses, but out here, there is rough water.
And many vessels went down at the Women's World Cup. The Commonwealth Games sevens. And despite a few moments of good cheer, the under-20s.
Choppy waters indeed, men. And so it is that we sail into the sea of confusion.
Batten down the hatches. Bring down the mainsail.
Hard to starboard. Splice the main brace.
Because, Seaman Overpun?
Because, me hearties, this is no ordinary trip.
The Six Nations. Soft cards and hard shoulders.
Wales and Cardiff Blues player Andy Powell drove a golf buggy down the M4, all because he wanted some breakfast.
There was a great comeback. But 2 years after winning the Grand Slam, Wales slipped down the table, down the rankings. This was sinking in style. But it was France that won the Grand Slam. The summer, long and hard, and not particularly sunny. Final glimpses of players who wouldn't be fit to finish the year. Leaving others to go through the autumn without much warmth.
And Cutley Beale inside, and Cutley Beale for the line. But will Richie reaches through?
There were glimpses of what one day might be, and there were near misses against the very best. But there were also some nights to forget. Well, one night in particular. A gloomy night. But somehow the ship stayed afloat, and the crew must now fight to hold her steady as she goes.
Soon we shall sail into the Southern Ocean for the big one. What say you, men?
Rudder's damaged.
The mast, she's split.
Chart's ruined, sir.
Tell them, Hornblower!
We sail on, Captain, to the Six Nations, to New Zealand, to infinity and beyond, with purpose and hope.
In our hearts.
Remember Captain Scott, then.
Didn't he, die?
Then we'll go down fighting. Cheer the men, Overpun. What have you there?
Captain's log, sir.
Rally the men, Hornblower.
All hands on deck.
We are sailing.
So where are we? Well, we're on some great adventure, some voyage of discovery. So we may as well just go for it.
So, a bit frosty for Eddie and the lads at sea. It was a bit warmer back in the Ryder Cup clubhouse. Well, let's talk Welsh rugby in 2010 with Jonathan Davis. Jonathan, first of all, do you like the surroundings here? This is where Monty did his speech.
Great place, and it was a great event. It was a fantastic tournament, and it put Wales on the map, which is fantastic.
Yeah, great moment. Can't say great memories about Welsh rugby this year. How long do you think will it be before Wales claim the scalp of a South Africa, or an Australia, or New Zealand? Because, in fairness, in the autumn internationals, they have played well in phases, haven't they?
Yeah, I look at it and I look back. They could have beaten Australia. They should have beaten South Africa. They should have beaten Fiji. And then 13-12, New Zealand with 14 men. If they had the confidence and the composure for the next 10 minutes and gone in front, we would have then seen how good this New Zealand side was, because they didn't respond when Australia beat them, and when they do get put under pressure, they do lack their composure. So, you know, that would have been an opportunity to see how good New Zealand were, but we didn't take it. So it looks like a poor run of results, but it could have been different.
Roger Lewis says he has no regrets about issuing Warren Gatland with a four-year contract. What are your thoughts?
I'm not really sure. I think Warren at the moment is the right man for the job. And because of the lack of strength and depth, irrespective of who you put in, I think you're still going to have the same problems. So is it worth changing and chopping, the coaching staff, or is it best to get continuity? Well, I feel that maybe at the moment continuity is the best thing. Maybe we should have maybe reassessed it after the next World Cup. But, you know, what's happened's happened, and I think you've got to go with it now.
Looking ahead to 2011, then, obviously, the Six Nations are going to be fascinating, aren't they? A centre partnership, maybe, of Henson and a fit Jamie Roberts. I just wonder, Jonathan, whether you think a back line of Shane Williams, Lee Halfpenny, Gavin Henson, Jamie Roberts, I mean, Mike Phillips, I mean, you know, that's some side, isn't it?
I would be interested to see where, if Henson comes through and plays, you can't say he's going to come back. You know, who knows? You might not get into the Saracen side. That's the key for him, is to get back and play. And if he plays well for them, I'm sure he'll be in the squad. But you've got Hook, Henson, Jamie Roberts, if they're all fit. Andrew Bishop, again, Shanklin played well. Would you then consider playing Hook at 10 for Wales? You know, and maybe add something different from although Stephen Jones has played well, you've got to look, to the future now, and the game is more attacking. I'll put Stephen Jones on the bench for cover. It's going to be an interesting selection. Wings are a weakness for us. Shane's back. Yeah, we need someone to really step up to the plate. And then we need cover for Lee Byrne. But with everyone playing, I agree. You know, it looks a very, very strong side on paper. And just getting that confidence factor.
OK, Jonathan, great to see you. Thank you very much indeed. Jonathan will be back later to talk rugby league. For now, though, let's head out to Lisa.
Now let's turn our attentions to a 23-year-old Kevin Forrest boxer. With the world at his feet, and a fair amount of power in his hands, too.
This is the fist of Nathan Cleverley. It can take your head clean off. The question you've got to ask yourself is, do you feel lucky?
In January, I went in for my final exams. I had three exams. I'd done well in those. But then within 2 weeks after those exams, I was boxing for the European title. But unfortunately, I felt really bad going into that fight. I was drained from all the studying I'd done for the exams. I was training, revising, staying up late. all I was doing, you know, doing my uni work. I remember waking up on the morning of the fight, and it's like if anything just hit me all at once. I felt drained, my throat, I had a sore throat. And in reality, I should have pulled out of the fight, but I thought, you know, the night is near now. I can't pull out this late, so I've got to go for it. The first three rounds, I was a little bit conservative because I obviously didn't feel too good. But I made sure I was winning the rounds. And then round four, I caught him with, I think it was a right hand, left hook combination. And they landed flush on his jaw. And the left hook actually shook him and his legs, they obviously buckled a little bit. And then I come back in with a big right hand on his chin, it landed clean again. He kind of buckled a little bit, and then straight after I landed another right hand. And once again, his legs done a little dance. And towards the end of the round, I knocked him down. And then the bell went to end the round, so the bell saved him for that round. And then coming out for round five, I knew this was the round where I'd done all the damage in round four, and then round five was just the round where that's where I had to finish him then. That was the most happiest I've ever felt in my life, knowing that I felt that bad going into the ring, but pulling off the biggest fight of my life and the most important stage of my life, really. I had another set of final exams in May and June to cap off my university work. I passed those, graduated in July, and then we had a call for a world title eliminator for September against an undefeated German guy, Karo Murat. He was a tough opponent on paper, probably the toughest fight of my life. I knew from before I even left the change room that I was going to win that fight. I was so confident. I knew my preparation had gone well, and then in the ring, the first round, it felt great. Set a pattern, and I maintained that pattern right up until round nine, where the doctor came in and said, he's taken enough punishment, it's time to get him out. And obviously the latest fight then was meant to be a defence of my world title. Unfortunately, due to political issues, the world title wasn't on the line. And I won against a tough French guy, Mohamedi. It was a tricky fight, a good learning fight for me. He was a slippery, awkward customer. It wasn't the most exciting of fights. If I had my way, it would have been exciting, but unfortunately my opponent was a bit of a negative opponent. He'd stand back, he'd make me miss, he'd move, and he didn't want to engage much in a toe-to-toe battle, which is what I love, but he just wouldn't trade with me. So it ended up being a cagey fight where, you know, sometimes your styles neutralize each other, and you've just got to, in that type of fight, you've just got to go out and win the fight, make sure you get the win, and not do anything stupid. So that's what I had to do, and I done that, and I done it well in the end. I've watched it back on TV, and yeah, I was more pleased now than what I was actually on the night. I'm pleased with it. Overall, it's been a brilliant year, and now I can go into Christmas and enjoy it and be content with the great year I've had.
World domination next on the agenda for Nathan Cleverley. And there were plenty of medal hopes for Welsh boxers out in India too. Time now for the second part of our Commonwealth Games roundup.
Yes, the Welsh ladies really set the standard in week one in Delhi. Now it's the lads' turn to step up to the podium.
At the athletics track, there were some unusual sights and faces that were much more familiar.
31 now, Christian Malcolm. Is this his last chance?
Said, you know, this is the only time we get to represent Wales on a global stage, and it's every 4 years, and
This is my last Commonwealth Games and I'm glad to come away with something.
In the 400-metre hurdles, Di Green and Rhys Williams, the runner with speed in his genes. But which Welshman would prevail in Delhi?
400-metre hurdles final. Di Green and Rhys Williams right in the middle. It's Green to rise first. Williams has gone up rather slowly, but Green's really attacked this in the early part of the race. He's already up alongside Van Til. To the home straight, two Australians, one from Wales. He's got to get it right here over the last hurdle. It's much closer than he might have thought. He's got to fight for this gold medal. And Green's got a challenge to take. He's got his run him up. He's just done it. Commonwealth gold. Wales have a champion. And what a champion.
Won everything. I've entered over the UK trials, European Team Cup, the European Champs, the Commonwealth and the World Cup. So there's nothing else I could possibly want, I think. So it all bodes well for next year, and I can't wait to go back in training now and ready for the World Champs and then 2012.
When it comes to fighting, Wales have a certain reputation. There were medals for Kieran Harding and Jermaine Asari. But the star was young Sean McGoldrick.
The baby of the Welsh team, 18 years of age, from Newport, the schoolboy. Sean McGoldrick, 6'5 up, against the 30-year-old from Sri Lanka, Manju Wanirachi. McGoldrick in blue, tight guard. And he's got him again. It's a 7 apiece. Now one more punch, Sean McGoldrick, and you've got this. Right hand from McGoldrick was very close again. Wanirachi knows now, I'm sure he knows it's level. If it stays at 7-all, it will go to what they call countback right from McGoldrick.
That was a punch, that should have
scored. That was a great shot from McGoldrick. McGoldrick battering away, it's going to go to countback. Yes, it is. Wanirachi's got the hand up.
The winner slumped and the loser was left upbeat.
I'm disappointed, but I'm happy because I got a silver medal to come out game. I beat some fantastic opponents on my way there. I haven't had it easy, and I think it's just caught up with me now.
He's coming home with silver to Dufferin High School. I hope you are all very proud of him in Newport.
Joanne Breck lay down and shot away to bronze. Silver for Francesca Jones in the hoop section of the rhythmic gymnastics. And a pair of bronzes for Hannah Smith and Anwen Button in the bowls pairs. And in the men's singles, Robert Wheel, in his 7th successive games, won gold in style.
Yes! Oh, what a ball! What a result! Perfect sportsman, Robert Wheel, takes the gold.
Well done, Rob Wheel.
Some superb performances from Welsh athletes there. Well, as you can see, Commonwealth gold medalist Di Green joins me now. Di, great to see you. Considering the event very nearly didn't happen, I bet you're glad you went now.
Yeah, I was very happy that I went in the end. Obviously came away with a gold medal. There was a point where I was worried if it was go ahead, but I think India did a great job. Some things they didn't do as well as others, but on the whole, I have a great great memory from the games. And obviously, as I came away with the gold medal, I think everything went fine over there.
And what are your memories of the actual race?
The race itself, I thought I didn't go off hard enough at the start. And even though the South African guy I knew was the main threat was coming up on my shoulder, I never felt that I was once going to lose the race. I was always confident coming down the home straight, and on reflection, looking at my times, it was one of my strongest finishes ever. And yeah, I always felt that I was going to win, and that was probably because of my success earlier on in the season.
Well, it wasn't just Commonwealth gold that Di won. Let's take a look at some of the other highlights.
This season, everything Green touched turned to gold.
It's victory number one for Great Britain, and a superb performance by Di Green.
Gold medal winner at the British Championships, the IAAF Continental Cup and the European Championships in Barcelona.
Di Green looking to make his own bit of history here. Green away nice and strongly. He's got his training partner, Rhys Williams, outside in an even rise over the first hurdle. Rhys Williams now coming into it, and so is Di Green. It's going to be the two British athletes who are going to come into the home straight, really in contention with Melnikov. Di Green just stumbling a little bit off that one, but he now finds himself a metre or two in the lead. Rhys Williams will finish strongly, but Green is taking the last hurdle and is heading towards gold medal for Great Britain. Can Williams hang on for second? Green gets the gold, Williams the silver. 1-2 for Great Britain, 1-2 for Wales, 48.13. Personal best, takes him to third on the British all-time list.
Plus, he clocked a personal best of 47.88 seconds this season.
European gold, Commonwealth gold, Continental Cup, what a season, Di.
Yeah, those are the three boxes that were sort of that and the sub 48 clock and were the three boxes that needed to be ticked at the start of the season. And I was very, very happy to come away with the gold in both the major competitions and then to upset the world number one at the World Cup.
You're so modest, Di. You're talking about sub 48 seconds. Yeah. Sub 48 seconds, I mean, you know, that's an incredible run. And you only missed out on Chris Akabusi's 18-year record by, what was it, 0.06 of a second?
Yeah, it was hardly anything. I mean, maybe I should have pushed it a bit harder at the end, I think, but Chris has been very supportive. The first time he contacted me was via text message after the race and said, a nice run, mate, but close but no cigar. he went on to say lots of positive things as well, and yeah. He'd be happy for me to be the record holder in the near future, and you know, fingers crossed I will be.
Are you poised to text Akabusi? Yeah, next year that you'll break his record?
I've got that text saved in my phone. I have waiting for the moment to come.
So it's inevitable. It's going to happen.
I'm very confident it'll happen, and I think he knows it too. It's just he was lucky that I had no more races that season, so he's got the whole winter to have that tag of British record holder.
Welsh people will glow with pride at seeing you and Rhys Williams there up on the podium. Talk to me about that rivalry between you guys. You mates?
Well, we're not friends away from the track, but. Then again, not many athletes are really. It's sort of we go to sleep in the afternoon, we do to rest up, so we don't really have that much of a social life. We did train together last year, and that was very, very good. He'd obviously want to beat me, I'd want to beat him, and I put myself in that situation where I can't rest on my laurels, and I don't want to become complacent because I know he's going to be there, wanting that number one slot in the UK, and it worked out really good for us. A lot of other people may say it's slightly dysfunctional because we don't really communicate too much, but the stats don't lie. We both had PBs in Barcelona and came away with two major medals each this year.
OK, Di, thank you very much indeed, and good luck in 2011. Well, we've covered athletics, boxing, rugby and football. Believe it or not, there was even more success for Wales in many other sports.
On January 2nd, North Wales arrow flinger Mark Webster came third at the PDC World Darts Championships in London's Alexandra Palace. News of Wales's first major medal of the year came on January 7th, but it was 13 years late. Welsh athletes Jamie Walsh and Ewan Thomas finally got the gold they deserved, upgraded from silver after American athlete Antonio Pettigrew tested positive for drugs, ruling out the USA win at the 97 World Championships. At the European Athletics Championships in Barcelona this summer, Christian Malcolm burst out of the blocks to win silver in the 200 metres. 25 years after Steve Jones won the London Marathon, Wales's Dan Lucker won the Mini London Wheelchair Marathon. On the ice, the Cardiff Devils kept their cool. Finishing in the top eight during the regular season, they then went all the way to the playoff final, where they lost out to the Belfast Giants. In the surf, Swansea wave rider Gwen Spurlock retained her British title on the UK Pro Surf Tour. Golfer Rhys Davis won his maiden European Tour title at the Moroccan Open in March. He then came second in China, Spain and Wales. In women's golf, Becky Brewerton got her first ever hole-in-one, and 18-year-old Amy Bolden was selected for the Junior Ryder Cup team to face the USA at Glen Eagles. July was all about the Newport Carter and his unstoppable machine. Jordan Chamberlain came second in the CIK FIA World Championships. At the Youth Olympics in Singapore, Jade Jones from Flintshire took Taekwondo gold in the 55K class and also picked up the BBC Wales Carwyn James Award alongside Welsh amateur champion boxer Sean McGoldrick. Wrexham rower Victoria Thornley won silver in the women's eight in the World Cup in Munich and took fourth in the World Championships in New Zealand. Also getting involved with the gold rush was Carianne Scudamore, who captained Team Europe to gold in the equestrian event at the Youth Olympics. Wales women's rugby star Non Evans, already a Commonwealth athlete in judo and weightlifting, took up a new sport and became Welsh wrestling champion. Former world champion triathlete Helen Jenkins came fourth in the 2010 Women's ITU World Triathlon Series. At the IPC World Swimming Championships, Dave Roberts grabbed four medals, including gold in the S7 100 metre freestyle. There were also wins for Rhiannon Henry and Nairi Lewis.
Nairi Lewis, gold, Great Britain.
Lewis also set a new world record in the 100-metre backstroke in Llandudno in July. But it was not to be a vintage year for Glamorgan cricket. Once again, no trophies, no promotions. And recent months have seen chaos reign at the club with coach Matthew Maynard, captain Jamie Dalrymple and president Peter Walker all resigning after chairman Paul Russell brought in Colin Metzen as director of cricket and Alviro Peterson as club captain. But there was one shining light down at the Swalex Stadium in 2010. In July, the club's legendary spinner Robert Croft became the first player to score 10,000 runs and take 1,000 wickets for one county since 1972. And then, just a week later, clinched a win over Gloucestershire with the first hat-trick of his 22-year career.
Robert Croft there, a legend of Welsh cricket. It was, however, a forgettable year for Glamorgan. Well, another team facing huge challenges in 2010 were the Crusaders, as rugby league continued to make its mark in a nation obsessed with the other code.
In 2009, the Crusaders had their share of problems and almost went out of business.
Whether they're going to appeal against the decision to deport them because of problems with their visas.
So they moved north to search for a new home. This saw them replaced in South Wales by a brand new club. The Scorpions, playing at the Knoll in Neath, finished the season mid-table in Division 1 of the Cooperative Championship. Settled in Wrexham, the Crusaders brought in Brian Noble and Yeston Harris, and a new chapter began. It started with the signing of Gareth Thomas, who received a typical welcome to rugby league. Against expectations, they reached the Super League playoffs, but lost to Huddersfield. The autumn saw the Crusaders' year turn full circle. Brian Noble left and debts dragged the club into administration. Committed to survival, 2011 could prove to be the defining year for rugby league in Wales.
So the Crusaders moved north, Jiffy, to kind of cement their place with the franchise. Do you think it worked?
On the field, they did, because no one really expected them to do as well as they did. Got into the playoffs and really should have, you know, beaten Huddersfield in the playoffs. So great success on the field. Unfortunately for them, the financial problems off it. They went into administration. And with the franchise, they've got another year left, and then you know have to reapply for the franchise. That you know could be key. And if they haven't got any money to buy players, they'll just have to you know do with what they've got. And I think that's the reason maybe Brian Noble left, because he realises that you know to take them forward again, you'll have to you know buy more players.
How do you think they're going to cope with that, Brian Noble?
I've heard great reports about Yeston. I think. He was a great rugby player, rugby league player, and he will adapt very, very well. He knows the game inside out. He's got a very relaxed attitude about coaching. You know, he's a laid-back character. I think he'll do extremely well, purely because he understands the game inside out. And you know, he's shown for Wales that he can you know bring the best out of players as well, and that's key.
The future of Welsh Rugby League may be found in the national side, who achieved stunning success this autumn in the Alitalia Cup. After wins over Scotland and Ireland, they went to France to play the deciding match of the tournament. A tight game throughout, 5 minutes to go, and Wales were awarded a penalty. They held out, and the party began. Next year, Wales will join the league elite and face the top nations in the world. England, Australia and New Zealand.
Of course, Yeston's coaching the national squad as well. They've had a pretty good year, haven't they?
Well, they, again, like the Crusaders, they've surprised everyone. Not household names. The young lads have been you know, dragged together from everywhere. Lee Breers has been key, of course. You know, he is a fine player. He just orchestrates the side and moves them around the park, and that's what those youngsters need to beat Ireland and especially France. In France, you know, when they've got the Catalan Dragons there and they're playing week in, week out in Super League, no one really expected them to win that game. But they went there, defended heroically, took their opportunities, and just snuck it. And there's a big prize now next year. They're into the Four Nations, where they're in with the real big boys, you know. But they need exposure to that level, and it'll be interesting to see how they go.
Thanks, Jiffy. Thanks for joining us. Right, there's a chance now to remember some of the Welsh sporting heroes that we sadly said farewell to in 2010.
Jack Parry of Swansea Town and Ipswich Town won one cap for Wales. Mike Budd played for 10 years in the back row for Bridgend and then moved to Cardiff. Brian Godfrey of Preston North End, Aston Villa, Newport County, and three times for Wales. Dick Francis, crime writer and jockey on board Devon Lock in the Great Grand National of 1956. Linda Griffiths was the first woman jockey to complete the Welsh Grand National. Roger Addison broke his neck playing for Pontypool in 1966 and spent 44 years in hospital. Stuart Robbins played for London Towers and Thames Valley, also in Belgium, Germany and Ireland. Billy Gore, like his father Jack, was a dual international in rugby union and league. Once Austria's Young Player of the Year, Bestyan Idrizaj came to Swansea City from Liverpool. Brian Clark scored the winning goal 39 years ago when Cardiff City beat Real Madrid. Mel Hopkins of Tottenham Hotspur when they did the double in 1961. Robert Dickey, British featherweight and super featherweight champion. Gwyn Rowlands played for Cardiff and Wales against the All Blacks in 1953 and won twice.
So, picture the scene. Millions tune in worldwide to catch a glimpse. It is, after all, the third largest sporting event on the planet. And it's the biggest event this country has ever hosted.
After all the waiting, the pressure was on Wales. The pressure was on the staff here at the Celtic Manor Resort. The pressure was on Monty and his European team. Could they deliver?
Golf, one of the oldest sports that Britain has gifted to the world. From the very earliest days, local clubs held challenge matches. Golfers dreamed of playing their greatest game. Then came the national competitions. Golfers dreamed of winning the greatest game. The internationally famous names of golf, the Open, the Masters, the PGA, and that quaint little match created by an Englishman, Samuel Ryder. After 9 years of preparation, in 2010, the Celtic Manor waited to take its place at the center of global sport. Europe versus the USA. The 38th Ryder Cup had come to Wales. The world descended on the lower floodplains of the River Usk to witness the greatest event in golf. The first shot on the first tee on the first day of the Ryder Cup.
The atmosphere in that first tee was electric. I think it was fantastic. I think it was a football-y, rugby, golfy crowd, and it just managed to be okay. And it was a great honour for me to be there as their captain.
Marty Lee Westwood.
But this was autumn, and as the Celtic Manor had become the 13th course in Europe to host the Ryder Cup, the dark, heavy rain clouds brewing above the Bristol Channel made landfall. The match was halted, and the fans waited. And they waited.
We just couldn't continue. The course was drained very, very well. Extra drainage was put in, but nothing could withstand that amount of rain.
The teams came out again in the late afternoon. The Europeans weathered the storm surges coming from the States, but then smashed into an American hurricane powering its way over the course.
Things weren't going well. No, there's no question that to allow the Americans momentum was the wrong thing.
As dusk drew in on the first day, for Europe, the lights of victory were a dim and distant sight. Saturday, the weather calmed to allow a full day's play, and then a match broke out. From first light to darkness, the teams were locked in glorious battle. With fairways as soft as sponge, the rough was to be avoided. The long-hitting Americans were thought to hold the key. After the four balls, Team USA was marching to victory. Monty, with his Welsh buggy driver, Rhys Davies, rallied his troops. Europe needed to mount a huge counteroffensive.
To go to bed on that Saturday night with six blue in the European column was incredible.
The third day brought another deluge, but the ground staff, the fans, and the players were to pull the match out of the mire. At the Celtic Manor, Tiger Woods held the feudal claim to be the world's number one, but a Yorkshire man was lying in wait. Westwood and Donald led the European charge.
For Westwood and Luke Donald to beat Woods and Stricker 6-5 sent a bit of a shockwave through their team, I think.
Poulter played like a man possessed. The Americans boomed. Donald was electric. Jimenez, smoking. It was a Sunday to dream about. One of the greatest days in European golf. The Americans didn't win a single point. And so, for the first time, the Ryder Cup went to a fourth day. Wales took its place in the sunshine of the world.
It was brilliantly done. The whole staging of the event was a tribute to Wales and what they had achieved in that Ryder Cup. It was a bad hour and a half on that Monday, very, very bad hour and a half, where nothing was going right. Thank goodness Miguel Jimenez did a great job. Ian Poulter promised me a point, he got it. And then there was this scenario with Ricky Fowler, how he finished with four straight birdies against Eduardo Molinari and managed to get a half, which was, that was unexpected.
All came down to the final match. Northern Irishman Graham McDowell against the Californian Hunter Mahon.
This was now the most important shot for us. He was one up with three to go. I knew at this stage immediately that he had to win and not even tie. And tie was a defeat. So it was one of these situations where he had to hit the fairway. That was the first time that I could really breathe a sigh of relief.
Oh, what a moment to hold back.
On the next hole, Mahon couldn't hold his nerve, and the 17th green dissolved into a brilliant shade of European blue. The Celtic Manor had been the film set for one of the most breathtaking sporting dramas these islands have ever witnessed.
Wales are remembered for staging possibly the greatest golf event ever.
What a week for European golf and for Wales. Well, that's it. Another vintage year of Welsh sport.
Yes, but don't worry. In January, it'll start all over again. A new year with new goals and new dreams, with new heroes and villains.
From the room where Colin Montgomery plotted Ryder Cup glory, North Star.
And Merry Christmas. Snow is falling, snow.